Trust is important for our employees, our clients, and our potential customers. And as entrepreneurs, we need to learn how to create it. As business professionals, we need to learn how to choose who to be in partnerships with so that we're able to protect ourselves and our businesses from lawsuits and poor decisions. Our guest today is Mary Kelly. Dr. Mary C. Kelly, PhD, CSP, CDR, CPAE, Hall of Fame, U.S. Navy retired, and of all of her titles, her favorite is teacher. She's focused on teaching professionals to navigate the economy, build their business, be a true leader, and get more done. Mary has authored 13 books on business and leadership, and today she's sharing with us a few ways not to be easy prey in business. I'm your host, Chris Parker, and this is the Easy Prey Podcast. Dr. Kelly, thank you so much for coming on the Easy Prey Podcast today.
Chris, I'm excited to talk to you today about ways businesses can not be one of the prey.
I like that. So can you give us a background about what you do with business and leadership?
So mostly I work as a corporate speaker, as a corporate advisor, and I improve profit growth. Many companies do real well. For the last 10 years, we saw great sustained economic growth. That was really nice. And people got a little complacent about their businesses. And this year, when things got a little bit more challenging, all of a sudden we saw stresses on people and businesses. And as you know, anytime there's a stress, people tend to go to the dark side. And that's where I jump in.
Gotcha. So let's talk about that. What are some of the things that we see happening to businesses when the economy takes a downturn?
So first off, businesses have to make sure that they are protecting themselves against people who want to sue them for stupid things. So there's a couple aspects of this. First off, you as a business person want to make sure your business is seen as trustworthy, but you also want to make sure you're not setting yourself up to be easy prey. And in a conversation I had this week with one of my clients, they're looking to hire someone. And so just on the I said, so what kind of questions do you like to ask people? And he says, well, we ask these. I'll go, stop. You can't ask those questions. And he said, we're a family-owned business. We're not corporate America. You know, I want to make sure they're a good fit. I said, yeah, you can't ask those questions. So first, one of the first things I like to tell people is, please make sure when you are interviewing someone to come into your organization, please make sure you are not asking questions that could be construed as illegal questions or questions that are maybe could be interpreted as being part of that protected category of potential employees. That's number one. Number two is making sure that people, you are not easy prey for a lawsuit. And by that, I mean, you got to make sure that if you've got a physical brick and mortar building, that your area is safe. Out here in Colorado, where I am, we get ice and snow all winter long. It's actually a law that says you have to clear your sidewalks. And if they're not, people can sue you. Because remember, anytime people see there's easy money, they're going to call a lawyer and they're going to try to sue you. So just making sure your brick and mortar places are kept up. There's not huge cracks in the sidewalk. Your parking lots are good. All of those things. And you've covered all kinds of crazy reasons why people have sued businesses.
Yep. I've seen lots of crazy things out in California. We have a litany of things we have a litany of groups that are professional litigants that go around businesses and do things like they measure the height between the floor and the bottom of the mirror in the bathrooms. And if it's, you know, a half an inch too high, they file a lawsuit. It's not about that a consumer couldn't see themselves in the mirror, but it's about that half an inch.
Oh, absolutely. And I have a group, I work with some people who have RVs and they run campsites for RVs. Well, sometimes in some of these really nice campsites, there's a swimming pool. Well, that's kind of nice. You show up, you've got your RV, there's cabins, there's a swimming pool, usually a little store, a place to get coffee maybe. Well, there was a group of people who were calling different campsites, asking if they had an ADA approved lift for the campsite. And when people said, well, no, I don't think we do. Like it's basically our own personal pool that we just let our guests use. They would sue them because they said it was ADA. Now, what was amazing is none of the people who were calling and initiating the litigation were actually handicapped. So here's the problem. And that to me, I mean, I know people who live in wheelchairs. And when somebody is going to go out there and not just misrepresent themselves, but in the name of promoting this for the people who actually do live in wheelchairs, well, now guess what happens? Now they just close off the pool for everybody. So there's people out there who are trying to take advantage of good people trying to run good businesses.
Yeah, and there's that distinction between legitimate, I don't want to say, well, I didn't know the regulation. There's some things you absolutely better know running a business.
Sure.
But there's, you know, I wouldn't expect the person that has a printing company to know how high the mirror has to be up off the floor, especially if it wasn't originally their building. They just moved in and took over it and, you know. Mind you, things need to be compliant, but I wish it didn't come down to these organizations that were just litigious about it.
The professional litigators.
Yeah.
Right now, again, in times of stress, and let's face it, this has been a tough year. And for many businesses, where all of a sudden they realized that they were vulnerable to something, all of a sudden this year has taken a big old spotlight on our businesses and showed us where some of the cracks were. And those cracks are the areas that I think you can help people with, because it identifies, hey, it doesn't take that much to just be a little bit better in these areas to protect yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. I was thinking about these other scams that businesses go through with professional litigants, but let's not belabor that point. You need to be aware of these things. Do you see that it's more commonly that it's minority-owned businesses and like immigrant communities that are targeted for these types of complaints?
Statistically, no. Statistically, no. People are just looking to take advantage of anybody who's got money and who doesn't know the difference. How many phone calls have you gotten recently about your car warranty? How many phone calls have you gotten recently about your credit card? Well, how many times they do prey on older people for all the computer scams. Yeah. You know, they pop up on your screen and it's like, hey, I'm from Microsoft or I'm from Dell or I'm from HP and give me control of your computer so that I can take all your bank account numbers and wipe you out. Things like that where they absolutely prey on older people. And a lot of times older people don't even realize it. The standard scams on Facebook, hi, you know, I'm a lonely widower. And, you know, Chris, your picture caught my attention. You just seem so nice. And I would like a relationship with you. I mean, there's personal sides of that relationship. But on the business side, we also have to make sure that when we see something that, and maybe it's a service we're looking for, that if it's too easy or too cheap, it's probably not real. Now, you can find great deals online, but there's ways to do that. And what you do is you ask your friends, you ask your other business owners. This is why I love the networking of chambers of commerce. I love CEO groups like CEN, EO, YP, the BLRs, Vistages, because they've got networks. So if you're looking to hire somebody or you're looking to get a service or a product, go to your networks first. These are your trusted people and say, hey, I'm looking for someone who can run my social media. I'm looking for an admin assistant 10 hours a week. I'm looking for somebody who can build a website. And then look at what they've done in the past. And boom, it could be legit. If something is out of the blue and it's way too cheap, you kind of got to wonder, And then think about it. If you're going to go to your CEO group and go, hey, what do y'all think about this? And you don't even want to ask the question because it just makes you feel like you're being stupid. It's probably a bad idea.
Probably. Like on the flip side of that, are there things that businesses should be doing to make sure that they don't look like a scam?
Absolutely. So as a business, one of the number one issues that people want to know is, can you deliver what it is you say you deliver? And again, we've all heard the roofing scams where they show up, they take off half your roof and take all your money and they never come back. All kinds of construction scams are out there. And in business, it's the same way. So a couple things I advise my businesses to do. First off, Google yourself, Google your business and your name, and you've talked about this before, but do it on a computer that is not yours or use your incognito window so you're getting a fresh organic look.
Yeah.
And then see what comes up. Number one. Number two, look at your Yelp reviews. Maybe somebody has you confused with somebody else. My name is Mary Kelly, and it's a very common name. Kelly is the 65th most common last name in the world. And if you got a Kelly, you got a Mary. There's just lots of us out there. So I'm always having to work really hard on my SEO to differentiate myself from all the other Mary Kellys who are out there. And most of them seem like lovely people, but if somebody's trying to find me or they're trying to rank me, I don't want them ranking Mary Kelly, the Celtic singer, against Mary Kelly, the economist and conference speaker. It's kind of a different skill set. So look at your Yelp reviews. And then if somebody's got an issue, say, hey, I think you might have the wrong Chris or the wrong Mary, and approach them and say, hey, whatever it is, I'd like to make it right. But also make sure that if you know you've got reviews out there, like in the medical community, they'll say, hey, this particular healthcare organization is where all of our rankings are. And if you were happy with our service today, we would love a review. Ask for the reviews. And many of us in business, we just forget. We just don't do it, or we think that it should come from them. But remember, people don't know. And as my grandma used to say, if they don't know, you tell them.
Yeah. And if you don't ask them to do it, it's really unlikely that they're going to do it. People only do stuff when they're either super excited or super upset. And it's more often when they're super upset.
Absolutely. And trust is everything in business. The book that I wrote a couple of years ago with Peter Stark, he's out of San Diego. It's called Why Leaders Fail and the 7 Prescriptions for Leadership Success. And what was interesting is we asked 100,000 employees, hey, why are you not able to do a better job at work? You know, what's getting in your way? Where are the obstacles at work that's preventing you from being as good as you'd like? And so we taxonomized all of those responses. And there were 7 categories. And the second most populated category was trust. And that was that their leaders were inadvertently losing trust with their own employees. Hmm. So they were like, well, how is that possible? And it was little things. It's not the big things. So within your own organization, you've got to worry about building trust with your own people, because how you build trust with your people is how they build trust with your customers and your clients. And it's little things that get people tripped up. It's, hey, I'll follow up with you by next Thursday, and then not calling back. Or it's, hey, yeah, I'll get that done for you, and then not doing it. Or it's not telling people the whole truth, like forgetting that shipping's not part of the invoicing process. Little things like that. People do not like surprises. And so communication solves a lot of those problems, but you've got to look at building trust within your organization so that your people can build it with the customers, but also looking at your online trust profile.
Yep. There's a process that I now go through due to a previous mistake I made, in that when I, you know, someone approaches me or I approach someone about wanting to do business, there's like key things that I look, you know, how long have they owned the domain name? Did they register it last week? You know what? Unless you're a startup and I know you're a startup, I probably don't want to do business with someone who just started their business last week. Mm-hmm. Is there a telephone number? Is there an address on the website? Is there clear contact information? Like, those are my hot buttons. Like, if it's not abundantly clear how to get a hold of you and where you're located, I immediately start wondering, well, why do you not want me to find you? Like, I understand that there's this concept of, like, you know, with let's say web developers, well, I don't want people to know that I'm working out of Bangladesh or something like that. Like, I'd much rather know where you're working out of than not know, because then immediately I'm like, okay, why don't you want me to know? And it erodes that trust.
Right. And knowing is better than not. People can handle uncertainty. They cannot handle uncertainty. They can handle bad news. And I've got a great guy who works for me, and he's out of Pakistan, and he does my PowerPoint. He does things like that. I love him. One of my video guys is in Morocco. I love them. They are fantastic. And right away, they were like, I am in Pakistan. I am in Morocco. And here's why I love them. When I can send them a job at night and I wake up in the morning and it's done, it's magic, because we use the time changes for us. So to me, that's an advantage. It may not be for everybody, and I totally understand that. Social proof is huge when you are vetting someone.
Yeah.
And I made mistakes early on where I took someone else's advice about their particular business coach. I was looking to get better in one area. And this one guy said, oh yeah, this person's great. Really great endorsements. I only asked that one person. Huge mistake. Cost me thousands of dollars in both fees and bad advice. I will never make that mistake again. So that's part of it. So getting social proof from more than one person is huge. The other thing I advise people to do is you got to vet them on LinkedIn, which means you better be on LinkedIn. Yep. Before I do business with anybody, LinkedIn is the place I go. I want to know if you're real. I want to make sure if I should spend time with you. And I want to make sure that you don't have bad reviews. And if you only have one or two testimonials on LinkedIn, I'm probably going to look twice about that. And it's hard because many of us who are brought up to be humble and don't blow your own horn and don't ask for those testimonials and all that, we're not very good at asking for referrals or asking for testimonials, which is why we need to hire great salespeople who will do that for us. I have an assistant, and after I do an event, she goes back and she asks those people for testimonials. And then we ask, can you either do one on LinkedIn or go ahead on my site, put a testimonial there so that people can see what it's like to work with me. Not everybody is going to want to work with every single other person. One of my books called Master Your World, I put a dog on the front cover, and it's Master Your World. It's really military, but I was trying to soften it, you know, because I spent all that time in the military. So it's 10 leadership lessons, but I called it dog-inspired leadership lessons because military stuff makes it sound like Patton or Eisenhower or MacArthur or something like that. And then somebody said, but some people don't like dogs. And I said, then I'm probably not going to want to work with them. And that's perfectly okay. So don't be afraid to differentiate yourself and brand yourself for the core values you're in. I mean, you've got a great dog. So you and I, it's easy. You're like, of course you put a dog on your front cover. Why wouldn't you want to do that? But not everybody is going to think. Somebody was like, well, I don't know if this is a book about dog training or what. And I'm like, okay, so you said that kind of wrong. So it's just not going to work. Yeah, it's just not going to work, not going to get anywhere close. So yeah, but trust is everything when you're running a business, and you've got to convey the part where you are trustworthy to work with. And that means letting people know right away what your core values are. Hey, this is what we do. Anybody on my team can say, you know what, this particular client, we don't think they're a good fit. We just have a weird feeling. They were super mean to somebody on the team, or they said something that really set us to worrying. Mm-hmm. And then, you know what? We have a conversation. We decide as a group whether or not we're going to keep them, because we don't need that. You don't need to work with people you don't need to work with. That's kind of how that works. And people want to know, can you deliver, again, what you say you can deliver in the time frame you say you're going to do that? So then you need a past track record of that. And then back to social media, give people references. You know, old style references on resumes were there for a reason.
Yeah.
A lot of people never even looked at them, but they just went, oh, at least you've got six people who are willing to lie for you. Good for you. That's six people. Awesome. They could have been your cellmates. That's perfectly fine. But I look for social proof. And when I'm looking to hire people, I do the same thing. I am going to look at, and this is for everybody out there who's putting stupid stuff on social media right now. I'm going to look at that to see whether or not you're going to be a good fit for my organization and whether or not we want to work together. Because if you're putting stupid stuff on social media and there's a whole list of stupid stuff, and what your stupid stuff looks like might be different from my stupid stuff, it's going to look different. And that to me dissuades trust. It kills the trust aspect. Look on Nextdoor when you're looking at how your business is perceived and how you want to, and how, when you're looking for other talent, look on Nextdoor, look on Craigslist, look on those normal job boards. Many people look, we advertise for jobs on Indeed, but do you know how your company is represented on Indeed? All those comments people can make about you? Well, if only two people have ever quit your organization and they left after 4 days and they were mad and they were a terrible fit, guess what? You probably have 1-star reviews on Indeed, and people might be passing your company over for even applying because of those two people, because you haven't looked at what your online profile is. And again, it's all about building trust, conveying your values, and making sure that you are thought of as reliable in your space.
Gotcha. So when it comes to being a leader in an organization, we talked about looking for potential hires of, like, don't post stupid stuff, don't do stupid stuff. Are there things that leadership is doing that is stupid, that puts them and their business at risk?
All the time. So I'm fond of telling my businesses, look, every single time you have a conversation with a client, a potential client, a supplier, or an employee, you have to assume it's being recorded. And they're like, oh, but I'm like, you have to assume it's being recorded. Because it's so easy on any kind of watch, you can have an app where you just touch a button on your watch and they will never know they're being recorded. And they're like, well, that's illegal in a court of law. Well, really, you're going to get to a court of law? And sometimes it's because they want to transcribe notes later. It could be very innocuous. It could be because it's a follow-up issue. It could be so that they're not sitting there taking notes furiously while you're talking. But it could also be with ill intent. And you just have to remember that anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. So you need to just be mindful of your words. And if you're going to have a tough conversation with someone who works with you or a client perhaps that you might be firing or something, have another person there with you. And I recommend you record the conversation too. Just so you've, I mean, Nixon was right. Record everything. I know that some of you are not going to like that, but that's okay. Record things so you've got a clean copy of what that looks like. Store it. And then if it's a tough conversation with your employee, you can even ask, say, hey, I want to make sure that we record this conversation so that we're both really clear on this. And then they're like, oh, that's a great idea. And then you say, so I'm going to go ahead and click record on this. And if do you have a phone, you can click record too. Like, encourage them to do it so that you know you're on record. They know they're on record and it's all above board. And then have a third person there. And like we were talking about before the show, we're a litigious society and many people are looking at large corporations, maybe not to go to court, but maybe just to get a settlement so that they don't have to go to court. And some organizations are advising people, hey, just pay that person off so you don't have to do it. I remember when I was in the Navy, I took over a command and they had six pending lawsuits and they were all nonsense. Like, it was one person got the idea, told her five friends, and they all did the same thing. And my lawyer's advice, because this was the federal government, was just pay him off for this and get rid of it. I said, you can't do that. That's rewarding bad behavior. When you're training your brand new puppy pit bull to not chew on human skin, you know, you don't punish him, but you also don't let him do it. You replace it with another thing. Because if you let the pit bull puppy get away with bad behavior in the beginning, okay behavior. And I love dogs. I love pitties for sure. But you don't let them get away with bad behavior. The same with litigation. If one person does it, everybody's going to think, oh, that's the quick and easy way to get a nice paycheck that's going to be more than my retirement. You can't do it. If you are innocent, you go to court and you fight it, even when it's going to be tough, even when it's going to cost more money, because otherwise other people will think you're easy prey.
Yep. So are there other ways that entrepreneurs get taken in scams and fraud?
Oh, so many ways. So again, besides paying for bad advice, paying for things that seem too easy or too cheap, hiring a bad bit. There's so many bad business consultants out there. And I love it when somebody will call me and say, hey, Mary, somebody said we should call you because we need some help. I'm like, ooh, it sounds like you've been through some other really bad consultants. And I'm not exactly a consultant. I'm more of a corporate advisor because I look at the whole thing. And they're like, yes, and we hate all of you. And I'm like, okay, so I love you because you're kind of like those people who've looked at 100 really bad homes to buy, and all of a sudden we show you the good house, the one that you're going to want. So I kind of like the fact that we're not starting out with the good house and then showing you all bad ones and all that. So I kind of like being that person they call. But there's a lot of bad consultants out there. Don't get taken by bad consultants, because many of them are not in it to solve the problem. They're in it to get paid. And I have a bunch of friends who are lawyers. I have classmates who are lawyers, and I love the lawyers in my life, most of them. But a lot of lawyers are in there to continue getting hourly pay. And sometimes I can go in and say, look, I can, in 1 hour, I can tell you what to do. We're going to record this conversation. Here's the steps. And then you call me when you've worked through these steps. And it may take you a week. It may take you a month. It may take you a year. But I'm not looking for that next time with you. I'm looking for you to grow your business. And many people hire a consultant that's going to be, 2 hours a week, every week. And what those consultants do is they water down the content they're giving you so that they can extend their contract. And those consultants drive me a little bit crazy. And I, like I said, I made mistakes too. I got sucked into a book deal early on in my career, and I found out that that person had taken $5,000 from several other folks just like me and never produced anything. And to take that person to court was going to cost us all $50,000 a piece for $5,000. And it just wasn't worth it. Lesson learned. And again, it's one of those things, Chris, where if I had gone to my friends and said, hey, I think this is a really cool opportunity, they all would have said, "What? No. No, no. Are you nuts?" And I just had a situation with a medical firm where one of the people was approached to go do something else, and he didn't talk to the other folks about it. And when it came out, it turns out the person approaching him was an absolute scamster. And if he had just talked to the other people he knew and trusted, he would not have been taken in by that. So again, sometimes we were like, oh, this is such a really good deal. And, you know, maybe I shouldn't tell my friends about this. That's a big indicator that maybe it's not such a great deal. So don't get scammed by that. And there's so many good scams out there, and they're so convincing and they're so well practiced that, again, pick up the phone. My dad just got scammed. Somebody, my dad was on his computer and that little pop-up came and said, click here. You know, we're from Microsoft. They weren't from Microsoft. We think there's a problem with your computer. So 2 hours later, he'd given the guy control over his computer and all the financial data, and it took me 2 full days to clean it up, and it was just a mess. And it was, of course, a total scam.
That's funny. I just recorded an episode with Jim Browning, and he has like 2 million followers on his YouTube channel, where he goes through and while the scammer is connected to his machine, he goes out and connects to their machine. And the stuff that he has seen and that he posts on his YouTube channel are crazy. So everyone has to listen to the episode with Jim Browning. We'll link it in the show notes. But it was exactly like what you're saying happened to your dad. Exactly.
It makes me so mad because I'm like, you know what? Clearly you're a talented hacker. You could use your powers for good. And you choose instead to prey on my dad, who's in his 80s. So when I meet you, guess what? We're going to have a conversation. And my first two words are not going to be happy birthday.
Exactly. It was funny because I was thinking about, you know, mistakes that I've made and some good things that I've done and some bad things that I've done. Mm-hmm. I have a good consultant that I work with who, when I have ideas that seem interesting or opportunities that seem like, hey, maybe this might be too good to be true, I talk with them about it. I'm open about the things that I'm doing. That way I've got some professional feedback of you're being stupid. That sounds like a scam. You know, that outside opinion really helps. And there was a scam that I fell for that someone pretended to be a well-known vendor in a particular mm-hmm. industry. And I didn't do a whole lot of due diligence because it was the sort of thing that they probably would have reached out to me at some point. And so it didn't seem unusual. Went down this road, got all set up with them, and they were going to be running advertising on my website and paying me for it. And it turns out that this guy was pretending to be that entity. He bought the .net of their .com. All he did was change the phone number on the website to his, you know, voice over IP line. And I think I lost about 10 grand because of that. And like you, I was like, okay, I'm going to go to war. I'm going to find this guy. I'm going to make his life miserable. And then I'm like, you know what? The lawyer's going to – the lawyer's never going to get me the money back. B, the lawyer's going to cost a lot of money. C, this is going to take a ridiculous amount of my time. D, it's going to wind me up emotionally and drain me. I better just move on with my business and chalk it up as an expensive lesson learned.
That's exactly right. And I know some people who get really excited about this. I'm like, okay, so what did we learn from this? And they're like, well, but I'm like, no, it's a lesson. And we just need, that's why I love your show, because we just have to help other people not fall into these areas and not be the easy prey, because it is really easy for really smart people to say, oh, I'm actually looking for that. It's kind of the same thing as when you go shopping for new pens. And all of a sudden, all the ads on your Facebook page are now all about new pens. And you're like, wait, what just happened there? So there is some paranoia that's natural paranoia. But, you know, just because you're paranoid doesn't mean they're not out to get you.
Yeah, I mean, I think we all we need to do our due diligence. And that's I think, the danger when the economy is not so good. Business is struggling. We start looking for easy way outs. We start looking to cut corners. We start looking mm-hmm. to, well, maybe I can find a cheaper supplier for mm-hmm. X, Y, or Z.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I know you know who John Stossel is, and he, mm-hmm. back in the 80s and 90s, was doing these things about solar-powered clothes dryers, and it was literally a clothesline. Like, it was just the funniest thing ever. I mean, it's technically true, but that was just one of the things that stuck in my head, a solar-powered clothes dryer. It's a piece of clothesline. But they did send you the 50 wooden clothespins to use with them. And it was like a $49 package. I just thought that was one of the funniest things ever. But again, to stop yourself from getting taken advantage of. If you're a leader in an organization, assume everything you do, somebody is watching. Everything you say, somebody is recording. Any interview you are doing, somebody is going to be looking for an angle, and they can be very, very convincing. Make sure your business is perceived as being trustworthy and reliable. We deliver what we say we're going to deliver when we say we're going to deliver it, or ahead of time. Coming in below budget and before the deadline, those all build trust. If you're an employee in an organization, you can build trust with the people around you by what I call closing the loop. Just close the loop. If you say you're going to do something and you did it, go back and say, hey, Chris, just wanted to make sure you knew that I got that thing done on Friday for you, so you don't have to think about it. Take things off other people's plates. It builds trust. And in business, you can call up your client and be value add in a way that's not cheesy. It's not salesy. It's not taking advantage of them. But it's ways to stay connected. And that's one of the areas where I talk to my business people about how do you then increase trust with your current clients? Because sometimes we make a couple mistakes in business. First off, we don't stay in touch with people who want to stay in touch with us. When I first moved to Colorado, bought the house, the floors needed to be redone. They're wood floors. So some guy named Jason, and I mention it on every communication I have, because I'm hoping this guy finds me. It's been 12 years. He did a great job on the floors in my house. They really need to get done again. I've never heard from Jason. I don't know his last name in the move. I know I had his business card at one point in time. I have no idea who Jason is. Change the phone, whatever. It is not our client's responsibility to stay in touch with us. It is our responsibility to stay in touch with our clients, number one, in a way that adds value. That's critically important. Mm-hmm. So one of the things I do is every month on my whiteboard, I have my top 35, 40 clients, and I have ways that I do touch points with them every month in a way that adds value. It's not salesy. I'm not pushing anything. I'm just staying in touch, because many businesses are kind of like teenagers who only talk to mom and dad when they want to borrow the car keys. And that's not the way to build real trust in an organization. And what was interesting that might be interesting to your folks is for my 12-month January, I sent everybody just a handwritten note. Hey, I hope the holidays were great. Hope everything's good. So it's a handwritten note also because if they moved or there was some kind of shift, that would be an easy thing back. And then in February, I sent them one of my new 5 minutes per week, 52 weeks to building a better business book. It came out in February, big, nice book. So they got that in February and March. I use a sales intel engine. And so I find sales triggers about what's going on in their industry. And so I spend a half a day, takes me about 10 minutes per client. And I find something really interesting. I'm like, hey, by the way, in your industry, there's this cool change or there's this new regulation. Is that something that your people already knew about, you know, whatever? Or, hey, I just saw that you were profiled as one of the top 100 businesses in Denton, Texas. And they're like, wait, we didn't know about that. So you're just providing value added. That was March. And then I had another workbook that came out in April. And then, of course, you know, by this time we're in full COVID fun. And then I send things out about that. So the idea is to stay in touch in a way that builds trust, because when I interviewed about 40 other CEOs this summer for the project I did on a paper I wrote called COVID-19 and the Future of American Business, I said, look, I just want to ask a couple questions on this. And what they said universally is, we're not looking for new people to do business with. We are looking for our current suppliers to solve our problems. So again, that's one of the things that we in the business world can do, is look for those opportunities to solve those problems right now. And hopefully we've been building up this trust with them, so that when we call them up and say, hey, by the way, this is what some of our other clients are looking for. Didn't know if you might be looking for that too, but here's our new product offering. Boom, there you are. You've already got the BLT sandwich. They already believe, like, and trust you.
Oh, I like that. Believe, like, and trust. Ooh, I'm going to write BLT that one down. Sandwich.
And who doesn't like bacon, lettuce, and tomato? Delicious.
Well, I could do without the tomato or the lettuce and just have a bacon sandwich.
See, if you ever want to hack into all my stuff, using the word bacon might get you pretty far. Just saying.
Just add another bacon to your password. So it's bacon, 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 bacon now.
Right. Bacon, 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 bacon. Yes. 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 I love it. Love it.
So are there any other kind of scams that are currently like hot and heavy right now during COVID that businesses should be aware of?
So one of the things I ask you to please make sure you've got team meetings and make sure whoever's doing your books, your CFO, your comptrollers, and all the admin people, what they'll do is they won't go to your head CFO. They'll go to one of your admin people with these small little invoices, like $142.63, which seems like it would be a normal number, like $500. Clearly, that's way too weird, way too easy. But they'll throw in something little, just hoping it gets paid from a company you've done business with. Like somebody will hack into your email servers. They will know that you do business with, you know, the National Water Association or whatever. And so you pay them every month for water delivered to your office for $63. So then they'll send a bill for $65.32. And because they change it real slightly, again, like .net. And all of a sudden, the phone number will look very similar. So they're like, oh, okay, I guess we just didn't pay it. They hit pay. Well, now they add that, and it will take you sometimes 6 months or a year or never to figure that out. And then they start to put a one in front of it or a two in front of it. Hmm. Oh, another good one on that. Some car dealerships do some scams like that, especially for younger people or older people. Ooh. And it's so rude. So they'll say, yes, you know, here's the car, blah, blah, blah. And car purchases right now are high. The average car loan rate is very, very low. You can get a great car rate, depending upon your credit, between 4% and 8% if you've got great credit. I mean, it's really, really affordable. What they will do, though, is they'll advertise, you know, a 4.1% APR, annual percentage rate for this, you know, new car or whatever, or 0%. And then when you come back and then you take the car home, they're like, yeah, take the car home for the weekend. Come back Monday. We'll have all the paper. They put a one in front of that.
Oh, yeah. Always read the fine print.
So instead of 1.1, instead of 4.1, it's now 14.1%. Wow. Or instead of a 0% APR, there's a one in front of it. And you're like, wait, we didn't agree to this. Well, you signed the paperwork. Well, wait a second. When I signed it, it didn't have that one in front of it, because when you signed the paperwork, they said they'd give you copies on Monday and you did not take pictures of that paperwork. This is why your phone is a great tool to prevent fraud. If you're signing anything, get that app. I use about three different scanning apps. Mm-hmm. My favorite one right now is Scannable. I'm pretty sure it's free. I'm not an affiliate. It's called Scannable. And it takes pictures of things and makes them into PDFs, and you can drop them into a file so you have the record of them. If you sign anything, take a picture.
I know there's one scam that I've seen here in Southern California recently. Is that a company sends a letter that looks like it's coming from EDD, which is the government employment agency in California, saying that, you know, California law requires that you have these particular posters posted in your employee break room, and you can get them from us for like $8 or something like that.
Wow.
And so people are like, oh, okay, $8. Okay, I'll do that. And it's, you know, legally mandated that you must have these. Here's the fear and the emotion and the, you know, urgency. You must have them or you're at risk of being sued. And that actually is probably true, but I don't know. And so when people would call and place the order, it was a really hard sell for the $800 package. And when the person says, no, I just want the $8 one, they're like, okay, we'll send you the $8 one.
But they charge you.
And they just go ahead and charge for like the recurring $49 a month plan. And I got one of these in the mail, and it looked kind of fishy because it kind of looked like a government letter, but kind of didn't. And so I looked them up on Yelp, and there were thousands of one-star reviews of people telling their story of, I just wanted the $8 thing and they charged me $1,000 on my credit card. And when I tried to get them to cancel it, they, you know, they cussed at me and all sorts of profanity.
Wow.
And like, you know, people are like, I had to cancel my credit card because even though I told them to stop charging, they kept charging me. And
wow. I'm
just like, and they were like, it wasn't like there were just four or five reviews from like a bad, you know, there was a bad salesman that he was just doing a bad job. It's like, no, this is their business practice, is to just lie, mischarge. It's like, how can this place still be in business? But maybe it's offshore. I don't know. But whatever. It was scary to see thousands of reviews, but it looked totally legitimate. So that comes to that trust and verify.
That's what we say in military intelligence. In God we trust, all else we verify.
What was it? In God we trust, all else, all others pay cash.
See, that's great too. That is great too. We just got to be careful out there. We got to make sure that we support each So when somebody calls you up and says, hey, what was it like to work with Chris? And you go, Chris was amazing. You got to work with Chris. Chris is a dream. Yeah, all of that. And we have to not be afraid of asking our great clients for great testimonials.
And I think when people ask us for referrals, we need to be honest with the answer.
We do.
I mean, there are people that I've worked with that was like, you know, someone called in for a referral. I said, you know, I didn't have a good experience, but I think it's because we weren't a good fit. They seemed like they were professional, but it wasn't a good fit. So don't like, you know, I don't think they're scammy, but do your own due diligence. They weren't a good fit, rather than just saying, oh, yeah, yeah, you know.
And sometimes the more desperate people get, the more desperate they get.
Yeah.
I worked with somebody for a couple of years and everything was great. And then this year hit and I'm pretty sure scarcity mindset took over. And all of a sudden it was a problem. And we had to part ways. And it was really, really unfortunate. And I, you know, there's part of me that's, you know, that's like, was it me? Was it really me? Maybe it was you. Maybe it was me. No, it wasn't me. It wasn't. But all of a sudden things just, the deliverables didn't happen for months and months and months. And you're paying for it. And you're like, hey, if you guys can't deliver this, I need to not be working with you. And then like 20 emails went unanswered. And you're like, okay, I probably should have figured that out after the third or fourth.
Yeah.
But you know, we try to give people the benefit of a doubt. And when you're a trusting person, you tend to think that other people are trustworthy as well.
Yeah. I generally operate under the, if they initiate that they're going to be late with their deliverables, that buys a little bit of extra trust.
Sure.
Versus, okay, I didn't get the deliverable and now I'm the one who has to follow up and say, hey, why didn't I get it? And then the excuses come, you know, or the stories come. Look, if you're going to run late, tell me in advance.
And we've all done it. I mean, we've all been like, oh man, I'll get to that tomorrow. And then we don't. And, you know, I mean, we've all done it, but just a quick note that says, hey, I got a little swamped on Monday, Tuesday, really sorry. I need to adjust your expectations and I'll have it for you Friday. Won't happen again or whatever. If you've got a really good, legitimate reason, that's great. If you don't, just say, I screwed up.
Own it.
Cause we've all screwed up. I mean, we've missed a deadline. We write things down. I'll share with you every single day of my life. I use my productivity sheet. It's on my website.com free/free. They're all there. That way I can find them all the time. And I do it every single day. And then sometimes I'll go back through the sheets and go, wait, I didn't move that to another list. How could I have missed that? And I pride myself on not missing things because I'm pretty organized about stuff. But when I do, nobody beats me up more than me because I'm just horrified by this.
So if people want to learn more about you and what you do, how can they find you?
Productiveleaders.com, productiveleaders.com, because who wants an unproductive leader?
I don't know. I won't comment about that.
I know, right? I know. But that's what we get to do. I feel so lucky that I get to do what I do. I was able to translate a lot of the leadership and skill sets from the military into growing businesses. And you would not think that that would be in effect. But in the military, I ran pay and personnel divisions and offices and commands. And I was an HR director and I was a chief of police and I ran bases like Pearl Harbor. So it's big money, big people, big budgets, big locations, lots of logistics. And that's mostly what we do in business. And in business, it's really fun and the stakes are a lot lower.
Yeah. That's a great way to end. The stakes are a lot lower in business.
So if you make a mistake, you know, at a local thing, you know, maybe, you know, that your chai latte vanilla sugar-free foam wasn't perfect. You know, nobody's going to die. It's a whole different other thing when you're in the military. So I find business to be fascinating and fun and energizing.
Great. Mary, thank you so much for coming on the podcast today.
Chris, it's awesome. And let's make sure people are not easy prey.
Awesome. Thank you for listening to this episode of the Easy Prey Podcast. If you found this episode beneficial, help us with our own social proof by leaving a review at easyprey.com/review. Notes and a transcript of this episode with Dr. Kelly can be found at easyprey.com/44.